the agenda.
All right, take it away, Karidi. The question was, what is a near membrane?
Okay. So from the top of my head, from what I remember what we discussed, near membrane is a membrane that whose main objective is to provide access to the object graph on the other side of the membrane in ways that it preserves the integrity of the outside object graph. And let me try to articulate that better. So the idea is that when you see an object graph from the lens of the near membrane, you get the illusion that this thing is actually the same object graph. But when you make mutations to that graph, those mutations are only seen by you. So the side effects of those mutations is only seen by you. You're not going to affect the original or the object graph on the other side of the membrane. That was the whole idea of having a proxy infrastructure that allows you to achieve that. An example of it would be if you have a near membrane that protects your application. Anyone who's running code on this other side of the membrane, in what we call the sandbox, or the red side, we call it code, like you have a red side and the blue side. The blue side runs your application code. The red side might attempt to change the array prototype filter or array prototype for each. And the mutation that they try to carry on is visible for them. Every time that they call an array for each, they see that mutation, but the outer side of the membrane will not see it. They will not be affecting the integrity of the outer side. Does that sound like what we discussed last time, Mark?
I didn't follow all of that because I'm time slicing between that and babysitting the rebooting of my machine has decided to upgrade. So it'll be a while. I was not able to stop it from upgrading. I think what you said corresponds to the way I see it. Let me just mention what I think of as the higher order salient points, is that the reason the membrane is called a near membrane is it's trying to make the objects appear to be as if normal objects in this realm. It's trying to erase the realm boundary. So even if the actual objects are across in another realm, as seen through the near membrane rewires things as they go through the membrane so that everything just seems to be local in this realm.
Maybe I'm missing something here because I don't quite follow what's the difference between the near membrane and a regular membrane, Mark, with what you just said.
It okay. sounds like this, like transparency is the differentiating characteristic. It's not handing proxies, it's handing realm appropriate objects.
Okay, that's much clearer.
Right, so the example that I was trying to work, the example that I'm working my way up to in the talk, and you'll see how far I got with the slides, which is not quite far enough. But for a regular membrane, if you have a red proxy for a blue date instance, and you navigate to its prototype, you'll get a red proxy for the blue date.prototype. In a near membrane, if you have a red proxy for a blue date instance and you navigate to its prototype, you'll get the normal built-in red date.prototype. So when you navigate to the primordials, you're always getting your own primordials. You're never getting a proxy for the other side's primordials.
Okay, that sounds like a pretty normal distortion mark, if I were to implement it in ES membrane.
Yeah.
It is somehow a distortion, yes. And I think that's the high order. Like we have a membrane that is connecting two different realms. That's an important distinction from regular membranes. You could create a regular membrane in the same realm for separating two object graphs, but they belong to the same realm, and that's fine. But this case is that you have two different realms. You want to connect them via membrane. And this membrane somehow fixes the identity when elements are passing through the membrane. So it appears to you that you are actually operating on the main realm. And it does that by distorting the reference of the prototype chain. So you get your own prototype chains on both sides of the fence. Right. In a normal membrane, you will get what Mark says. You will get a completely different prototype chain, so checks like intents of and stuff like that will just fail.
Right. So I'm contrasting the fully transparent membrane, meaning a membrane with no distortions, versus near membrane, in which everything we've said so far can be expressed with distortions. What we haven't said so far is what about built-in methods accessing exotic internal slots. And that's where we get into trouble, and that's what the whole presentation that hopefully I will be able to present is about.
Can I echo back what I recorded just to make sure that it's correct?
Yeah, please. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so a near membrane is a membrane whose main objective is to provide access to the group to the object graph on the other side of the membrane in a way that preserves the integrity of the outside object graph. When you see an object graph from the lens of a near membrane, you have the illusion that it is part of the same object graph or realm. The difference is when you have a mutation, the mutations you make are only seen by you and not by the object on the other side of the membrane. Mark, you had a comment?
Yeah, there's actually a few things there. Mm-hmm. Go through each of those clauses and let me react individually.
Okay. When you see an object from the lens of a near membrane, you have the illusion it is part of the same object graph or realm.
Okay. So it's always part of the same object graph, where the object graph is, just defined by graph connectivity. So specifically, the issue is that it creates the illusion that it's in the same realm. Mm-hmm. The first clause that you mentioned the first time was something about integrity, and I believe that's the case for both membranes. They trying to preserve the integrity, trying to preserve separation between the two sides. Okay.
Okay.
What was your next clause?
The one thing there is that I believe we can narrow this to cases where you have two realms interacting with each other. I'm thinking a near membrane makes sense in a scenario where you only have one realm.
So putting the near membrane between the case that I was gearing up to talk about, which is I think the simpler case to explain, is exactly I think what you just said, which is when you actually have two realms, but you put a near membrane between them. So not only do the objects in one realm see the objects in the other realm through the membrane, but they see them as if they're in their own realm. So the inside the red realm, you're seeing a red proxy for a blue date as if it's simply a red date. Okay. Your other clauses?
Okay, just to make sure, I'm just going to make sure that we've got this all super clear. So okay. The first clause applies to any membrane. So a membrane has the main objective of a membrane's main objective is to provide access to the object graph on the other side of the membrane in a way that it preserves the integrity of the outside object graph. Now, I imagine we need to replace object graph there with realm.
No, actually, membranes are a cut point in an object graph, but the cases that we'll be considering are the ones where the membrane boundary coincides with the realm boundary, because those are the ones that are easiest to explain, and in particular, set things up to make it easiest to explain the difference between a normal membrane and a near membrane.
Okay.
So for explanatory purposes, we're only going to consider cases where the membrane boundary coincides with the realm boundary. The other thing is that the membrane has to preserve separation. It has to be impossible to route around the membrane and obtain direct access somehow, starting only from indirect access through the membrane.
Okay, I've added that. This will be a good definition to also add to the terminology document. And I just want to make sure that we're clear on the difference, this initial difference that you made between a near membrane and a regular membrane. A near membrane is different where, and the first bullet point is, when you see an object graph through the lens of a near membrane, you have the illusion that it is in the same realm. The
yes.
difference is a mutation. The mutations you make are only seen by you and not by the object on the other side of the membrane.
So I think that that is, Caridi and I might have a terminology dispute here, but I would say that doing that is a further distortion on top of the near membrane. I would like to define the near membrane as one that is fully transparent, providing the illusion of same realm, whereas the regular membrane is just fully transparent. And then something like not relaying mutations would be an additional distortion that you could do on top of either a regular membrane or a near membrane. And I think it's orthogonal to the regular versus near distinction.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah, you could get a membrane that does similar things, and it's fine.
Okay.
So now I just want to make sure that we're clear on what transparency means. When we say transparent, it means that there is no perceivable difference between what happens if you ran this in the same realm as if you go cross realm. Is that what that means?
I'm sorry, I had to. While you were talking, I'm sorry, I thought I could restarting my machine again. Say it again, Yulia. I just missed it.
Essentially, I'm just I want to nail down the definition of transparency in this case. What does that mean here?
Okay. So, in the case of a regular membrane, in the case of the regular membrane, where the membrane boundary coincides with the realm boundary. Interacting with objects in the other realm through the membrane seems the same as just a normal realm boundary without a membrane. So inserting the membrane between the two realms acts as if there is no membrane between the two realms. That's the ideal. Then in my talk, I'll talk about the difference between fully transparent and practically transparent. But for now, my previous definition is the fully transparent goal. Mm-hmm. For the near membrane goal, what fully transparent would be is that you can operate on objects that are on the other side of the membrane. And once again, for expository purposes, let's only consider the case where the membrane coincides with the realm boundary. So you can interact with objects from the foreign realm as if they are normal objects local to your own realm.
Mm-hmm. So Yulia, I think maybe a more practical example here, a more practical definition is like in a regular membrane, even with transparency, you might encounter identity discontinuity. While in the near membrane, you would not experience the discontinuity between different objects, because they will appear to be the same, all of them coming from your own realm.
So I want to refine that, because I think it makes it seem less transparent than it is. Between realms, you have identity discontinuity. So for a regular membrane to be fully transparent, it should behave as if you have exactly the same identity discontinuities. So it's not that the goal of a membrane is to erase identity discontinuities. It's that the goal of the membrane is to act as if the membrane isn't there. And in the inter-realm scenario, it should preserve the identity discontinuities you expect between realms. For the near membrane, because it's providing the illusion that everything's in one realm, in that case, it should, in fact, erase all identity discontinuities, just as you would if every object, if everything actually was in the same realm. Okay. Kariti, do you accept that? Do you accept that refinement?
Yes. Yep.
Good.
Julia, let us know if you want to get examples of these.
Mm-hmm.
If you need examples or use cases or something, we can chat about it.
I think
I want to test my internal agreement with what's being claimed by proposing a definition of transparency that corresponds with operations from one side of a membrane on objects received from the other side of a membrane that correspond with the same results as would be achieved if the membrane were not present. So if I get an array from one side of a membrane and I look up the property 0, I expect the membrane to be transparent in that case, that whether it's present or absent, that the lookup of property 0 on an array is going to give me the same data back.
Well, so same data is the tricky thing. If it's data, it should give you the same data back. If it's an object, it should give you an object that appears to be the same object.
Right, right. So so in this case, let's say I'm going to then do, I'm going to send it to console.log. So my operation is console.log with a single argument of array from the other side of a membrane, bracket 0. And I expect the membrane, like a good membrane would be transparent in that, in the sense that I will get the same results whether
it's
or
tricky.
Not. Like
tricky.
The existence of the membrane does not affect the results of that operation.
It's tricky because it depends on what console.log is. Console.log might be the console.log or your side, or might
it is.
Be.
No. I'm saying it is the only object in question to come from the other side of the membrane is the array itself.
Mm-hmm. In that case, when you do console.log, you get a proxy of that array.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the key thing is you get a proxy for the array. The elements of an array can hold data or they can hold objects. The membrane must maintain separation. So if you say array sub 0, if the contents of the original array at 0 is data, then you'll just get the same data because data goes through a membrane without modification. If the contents of the original, let's give them colors again. If you have a red proxy for a blue array, and the blue array at 0 is holding a blue object, then when you say to the proxy for the array sub 0, you will get a red proxy for the blue object. You will not get the blue object itself.
Yeah, that's the implementation mechanics. But in trying to define transparency, I'm saying that the implementation mechanics have no effect in the cases where transparency is achieved. that it actually doesn't matter.
Until you start introducing distortions, such as revocation.
Right, and those are the cases of non-transparency, right?
Right,
that's
right.
The cases where, so, yeah, where right. the membrane is observable.
Right, right, that's correct. So until there's some non-transparency, the observable equivalence should be should in theory be a perfect illusion. And then my presentation, which I think I'm actually projecting now.
I can see it.
We'll talk about some of the cases where we can't preserve the illusion perfectly. Once again, my apologies for not having finished the presentation by 1 o'clock. This is about explaining the tensions between exotic internal slots versus membranes.
Mark, do you want to go on the presentation or you want to finish reviewing what Julia has?
I'm sorry, yes, yes.
I would propose actually that what I'll do is send my notes by text and you can make corrections there just in the interest of time. And if I have further questions, I can raise them.
Okay. Yeah. The okay. original multi-clause thing that you said, I would like to, it was a small number of clauses, so if we didn't cover all of them, I would like to continue on those.
Let me just take a look. So I wrote down the new stuff that you mentioned. I have concrete example. I think we can skip that. That's array.prototype for each that Carity brought up. And then I have important points listed. The reason it's called near membrane tries to make the objects look like they are part of the same realm as the accessor, and near membrane rewires things to appear local to the realm of the accessor. So essentially yes. what's been said before. The difference between a regular membrane and a near membrane is transparency. It isn't, a near membrane isn't handing proxies to the accessor, it's handing realm appropriate versions of the accessor's realm.
You repeat the last part.
So I think there's two things. I'm sorry. Go ahead and repeat it, and then I'll interject.
Right. So the difference between a regular membrane and a near membrane is transparency. A near membrane is not handing proxies to the caller; it's handing realm appropriate versions from the caller's realm.
Okay. So no. Let me comment on both parts of that. Both kinds of membranes are trying to be transparent. So when you say the difference is transparent, the difference is what illusion are they trying to transparently uphold? But for each of those illusions, they are trying to uphold full transparency, or as close as they can get. The other thing is that for the near membrane, you will still often be dealing with proxies. So proxies are very common for both kinds of membranes. It's just that when you navigate from the proxy to other objects, for some of those other objects, such as navigating up to the prototype, it'll substitute a realm local object. But for example, from navigating instance to instance, you'll still navigate from proxy to proxy.
Okay, so what I have written down now is the difference between a regular membrane and a near membrane is how they uphold transparency. For a near membrane, you will still handle proxies, but in the case when you navigate from the proxy to other objects, such as navigating up the prototype chain, it will substitute a realm local substitute.
Yes, yes, perfect.
One addendum, if I may. I would suggest adding that a membrane can achieve this near membrane property with a distortion that should be relatively simple.
Okay, and for everything we've said so far, that is correct. There's special trouble when we get to exotic internal slots.
So before we jump into the presentation, Julia, I think it's just for everyone, like the reason why we invest time on researching on this is because if you are using a regular membrane or no membrane at all, the identity discontinuity is there, is a problem, is a big problem. In order for you to dismantle or remove the identity problem, either you move everything into the same realm and use a membrane to separate the object graph, and it has a bunch of issues with that, or you find some other ways that we haven't found yet. But the identity discontinuity is one of the real motivations of near membranes. And in the past, we say if you move everything into the same realm, you will have to freeze the intrinsics in order for you to not be subject to potential mutations on some of these objects from the same realm. And freezing, we know, is a complicated process, and it's also a tricky process. And so we try to find solutions that continue to have the separation between the realms. So you have your own intrinsics, you have your own evaluator, you have your own global object and everything. But then we use a membrane to connect this object graph and give you the illusion that you have that you're running the same realm with the same identity, but in reality, you're running separate. Mm-hmm.
That's clear.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure that we also have a definition written down for what a distortion means in this context. Ah. And a distortion in this context, from what I understood, is a break from representing the object of the other realm and switching to something else, for example, the current realm, the colors realm, let's say it.
So that is the particular distortion we're talking about. Mm-hmm. In general, taking a membrane mechanism and mm-hmm. introducing a purposeful deviation from full transparency is a distortion. So the optical analogy works well here.
Okay.
Yeah, and by the way, something that was mentioned 2 years ago when Mark and I gave our talk on membranes, we are mixing metaphors here between biology for cell membranes and optics for distortions. That's something that is just legacy. It's a mess, but the point I'm trying to make is, and I'm trying to repeat, is that you do not need to understand either biology or telescopes, optics, to understand membranes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. What I'll do is I will reorganize this a bit and try to make these definitions as simple and accessible as I can. And then I'll send them for review to this group in case something gets lost in translation. And then we can add this to the terminology document for TC39 so that in the future there's an accessible definition for this.
Great. Okay. So now I'm going to go into the presentation. Okay. So before we get to membranes, let's first of all just take a look at some cross-realm cases to see how realm boundaries work. This will also introduce some of our visual notation. So we have a red realm and a blue realm. In the red realm, we have a normal date object, and we do date.getDay, invoke getDay on it. Versus in the red realm, we start from the date constructor, look up the getDay method and apply it to a blue date, a date instance from the blue realm. Versus in the blue realm, we just do date.getDay on a regular blue instance. So these are the three objects involved. and the thick charcoal looking arrows are properties or well-known internal slots, like the inherits from internal slots, which I'm showing here as if it's the property Dunder Proto. So yeah, those are the navigable, well-known internal slots, and I think we can, without loss of precision, just whenever we see those, we just think of them as properties. So those are the three expressions that we're going to examine to contrast. And we're going to notate invocations using these thick arrows. So the date.getDay, the lookup of getDay with dot looks up the red getDay method and applies it to it's this, which I'm just introducing this dot call notation, but it's really just applying this method to the date instance as the this, and that's what this what the leftmost invocation represents. The middle invocation is actually explicitly a dot call invocation, and it's being sent to the same built-in red date method. But now the argument is the blue date instance on the right. And then finally, the rightmost one is like the leftmost one, but blue. It's just looking up dot get day on the on the blue date instance, finding the blue method and applying it to the instance. So now I'm going to, these funny looking purple arrows are internal slots. So the date instance has an internal slot named date value. And the eyeball in the built-in method is the built-in method has built-in magic where it can see internal slots that normal JavaScript code cannot. Because the the purple eyeball of the red built-in method can see the purple slot on the right, that middle invocation works. That's the important one. And of course, the other two invocations work. And the reason is that both internal slots are purple and both eyeballs can see both internal slots. Contrast this to the situation we would be in if date were not the built-in date, but rather a date abstraction that was coded using JavaScript classes, where instead of the internal slot for date value, we had a private field for date value. Well, now the invocation on the left works fine because the red eyeball can see the red internal slot. Likewise on the right, the blue eyeball can see the blue internal slot, but the red eyeball can't see the blue internal slot. So you end up with that middle invocation failing. And that's, there's no membranes yet. This is just the what would be the normal behavior between two realms if this thing were defined with classes. And obviously that means that for things that are defined with classes, where the classes are loaded into each realm, they're obviously separately executed in each realm. So you would get this behavior. Okay, now I'm going to introduce the visual language for explaining membranes. And for those who saw the previous talk, yeah.
Mark, before you move on, can you go back one slide?
Yeah.
I think it might be also interesting to showcase not the private field, but a symbol. If you use a symbol, then you will be able to make it work because the symbol is shared between the two realms. Maybe some of that.
Well, it doesn't matter whether it's a symbol named property or a string named property. If it's a property, then it works. So it's only the internal slots that cause these problems. Okay. So now the visual notation for membranes. So this is the individual objects that are the ingredients for building a membrane. Which is on the left, we have a proxy. Proxies are always going to be underlined. So I use underbar throughout the talk for proxies. The proxy directly has a handler and a shadow. The shadow is also called the shadow target, but it's the one, I'm just going to use the term shadow as the thing that the proxy mechanism directly knows about. And then I'm going to use the term target for the thing that the membrane treats as the blue object that the red proxy is a proxy for. So proxy one is a proxy for the blue target one. And then the two vertical bars are the two weak maps. There's a red to blue weak map, and there's a blue to red weak map. Alex has a fancier data structure that Caridi is also using. That's where the fancier data structure is relevant when there's more than two sides. But since we only have two sides, I'm just going to use this representation. The key thing about this representation is that the handler doesn't directly point at the target. The handler looks up the target in the red to blue mapping, starting from the proxy, and vice versa. So as you traverse the membrane in each direction, you use the tables to look up the thing on the other side. If there is no thing on the other side, you create one of these proxy configurations for the thing on the other side, and then you enter it into both tables. So now I'm going to use the following visual shorthand, usually so that we skip all the detail, which is the proxy and its handler and its shadow together are just the extended proxy icon. And this indirect pointing through the tables is just going to be seen as a pointer, not as a charcoal thick pointer. It's not a property like pointer. It's more of an encapsulated pointer. The way a closure captures things. I'm not going to usually talk about the separate red to blue versus blue to red. I'm just going to show that as a bidirectional table, and that is the membrane boundary between the red and blue. And now, going back to the explicit notation for a moment, for a second proxy and its target, if target two has a dot foo property pointing at target one, then in general, shadow two will have a dot foo property pointing at proxy one. And that's in order to create the illusion that proxy two acts as if it has a dot foo property whose value is proxy one. And that's the thing that preserves this transparency of property access across the membrane. And usually we'll just show the objects with the coloring, and we don't need to show the boundary explicitly. Okay, so now, let's take a look at normal instance method access across the membrane. So let's say in the red realm, we execute lowercase date.getDay, but the underbar here means that the variable lowercase date is not a red date instance, it's a red proxy for a blue date instance. So that is what's happening in the blue realm, just the real objects. And then This would be the corresponding red proxies for the blue objects. And the looking up the get day on the proxy for the date, that actually faults. I'm going to skip going through the property lookup to the result of the property lookup, because the interesting thing is the invocation. So the result of the property lookup is that the expression getDate.getDay is also a proxy. It's the date.prototype.getDay method proxy for the blue getDay method. And that's equivalent to taking the getDay method and apply the red proxy getDay method and applying it to the red proxy getDay object. So it's all on the device. And that punches through the membrane, both the receiver and the argument, so that that turns into applying the blue method to the blue object, which is just equivalent to having executed the original piece of code on the blue side. And the result is that that invocation succeeds. It returns a primitive value over there, and that means that that invocation succeeds on the left. Okay, so to recap, that turned into that, turns into that. Okay, now we're going to contrast doing the get day lookup by dot that we just looked at, starting from the date proxy. We're going to contrast that with using the native red built-in date.prototype.getDay method. Notice not underlined. This is not proxies for blue things. This is the actual primordial built-in method. But we're going to apply that to the red prototype for the blue date instance. So that's where we were. Those are the relevant native red objects. That's the invocation, where we're going to be invoking the red native getDay method on the red proxy for the blue date. And even though the built-in method has the same purple eye color as the internal slot on the right, the proxy doesn't understand the internal slot, so this thing fails. So that failure is a violation of transparency. And this is where we talk about the difference between perfect transparency and practical transparency, which the normal membrane suffers from. That is the end of the polished slides. So now I'm going to go through the unpolished slides, and I'll just apologize once now for their roughness. So the reason why I'm saying that it's a violation of transparency, but we're still preserving practical transparency, is that the blah.prototype.something.call of something else is odd code. It's not, it's not super rare. There's enough code that does that, the things will in fact break, but it's still comparatively odd code. Whereas the normal instance invocation is not the normal instance invocation is not odd. It's by far the more prevalent case, and that one works. And the reason that that one works is because the built-in method in question, the getDay method, was only accessing an internal slot on its this argument. And almost all of our built-in methods that access internal slots actually do it only on their this argument. And that preserves practical transparency. However, there's some built-in methods that have that engage in privileged access to an argument other than their this argument. So each of these things is one of those violations, and each of these preserve practical transparency for a different reason. A red native reflect.apply applied to a red proxy for a blue function will work because a proxy for a function is a special type of proxy we call a function proxy. And function proxies have the call and construct behavior of their shadow. So the membrane knows that when you're making a proxy for a function target, to also use a function shadow so that you have a function proxy. And reflect will apply function proxies just the same way it applies functions. Array.isArray, sorry, is it a question?
Just a clarification. This problem is more important when we talk about objects that whose prototype is undeniable intrinsic. In the particular case of date, for example, the way we solve this in our near membrane is that because you don't have a way to create a date out of code, we just replace the entire access to the date object graph when we boot up the membrane. So the dates that you will create will always be the dates of the other side. You always right. see them as proxies. But if this is a way to do a way to create an object whose prototype is undeniable, then is when this problem actually present as a challenge.
Right. So I'm going to get to primordial replacement when we get to monkey patching the primordials when we get to near membranes. But for regular membranes, there's no need to monkey patch the primordials. You can just leave the primordials as they are, and everything still works. All of these things that I'm explaining still work practically transparent. Array.isArray is a interesting case, which is also, by the way, JSON Springify. I should have written that down as well. Both of them will detect whether the argument is an array where the argument is not this argument, it's some other argument. Because those things are non-this arguments, and because array.isArray and JSON Springify is a very normal thing to do, it is not odd code, we introduced a special case into proxies where if the shadow is an array, then array.isArray on a proxy whose shadow is an array will say true. Okay. Array.prototype.map, this one, even if you do the odd thing like we did for date, all of the higher order array methods are generic. they actually don't care whether the argument is an array or not. They just access length and they access index properties, and they just sort of do what they would normally do with an array, but if you provide them a non-array, it will still just access properties with those names and do what it does. So therefore, a proxy preserving the behavior of the properties, length and the array indices, all of the higher order array methods will just work. You don't have to do anything special. And then the one that's going to the one that is a further compromise on full transparency, but still in some sense practically transparent, is that promise.resolve, when applied to a non-promise, I'm sorry, promise.resolve, first of all, when applied to a genuine promise, will just return the promise directly. Promise.resolve applied to a non-promise will do something else but return a new promise. And this do something else depends on whether the non-promise is thenable or not. So in the case of a red proxy for a blue promise, the proxy is not a promise. It is not the promise.resolve does not have a special case like array.isArray. So it treats it as a non-promise, but it is eventable. So the normal promise assimilation of eventables will be triggered, which is different behavior. But the reason we introduced the assimilation is for most normal promise code, it acts similarly enough. So for a promise code that doesn't care about the difference, it will remain practically transparent with the membrane in there. But obviously that's a further compromise of the difference between transparent in theory versus practical transparency.
Mark, on that slide, side note maybe could be that we can also say that array is array and JSON is stringified. They will because of the current behavior that we have on them, they make revocable proxies observable.
Remind me, there's some very subtle thing about the observability, and I don't remember what it was, but I thought we had all agreed it was a bug in the spec, the thing that makes it observable.
Well, we use it in many different places to determine whether or not something is actually a revoke proxy. So I doubt that we'll be able to fix that, but I think the issue is that because these methods will attempt to look into the proxy's target, that makes them susceptible to revocable arrays, revocable proxies that do not have access to that target anymore.
Okay, I'm sorry. I might have misheard you. It makes observable for a revoked proxy, but it should not make any. There should not be any non-transparency observable for a revocable proxy that has not been revoked. Do you agree with that?
Correct. Yes. Correct. Yeah.
Okay.
But these are the two methods that allow you to determine that something is actually a revocable proxy. If it's not revoked,
a revoked proxy.
A revoked proxy. Yeah. A revoked proxy. Yes. Right.
Right. The thing that I care. So I think that's an issue that we should fix if we can. But the important thing for practical transparency is if the distortion is being revocable and the revocation hasn't happened yet, that you don't see it, that it's transparent until the revocation happens, and the revocation once the revocation happens, things will act weird in ways that are very different than transparency. But yes, that's a further violation that I really would like to see fixed. But beyond the level of detail that I'm trying to explain in this talk. Okay, so there's some morals of the story so far, which is that we should try to avoid introducing new internal slots. When we can't succeed at doing that, we should try to avoid introducing built-ins that require access to internal slots that don't have a generic behavior. So the higher array methods where they have a generic behavior that does the same thing in the absence of the internal slot, it would be nice for built-ins in general to do that. And you can see you can think of the venable absorption of promise.resolve as being a imperfect generic fallback behavior if you don't see the internal slots. And then if you fail to do that, then built-ins that do have magic access to the internal slot should do it only on their this argument. And then if you fail to do that, built-ins that have magic access to a non-this argument should do it cleverly so as to preserve as much practical transparency as possible. So this is sort of an ordered set of morals of the story. And then so far, we are writing off as unsolvable the case that we called out as the odd code that we're not able to make transparent. And now the for now is that near membranes, the full near membrane system with all of the monkey patching it requires actually addresses that case that I thought was impossible to address. So I also want to just give Kariti credit here for the near membrane invention, because I really did not think that the level of transparency that Kariti achieved was possible. So this is my failure to do any graphics for near membranes. Hold on. Am I still? Yes, I'm still projecting, David. This one. Sorry.
You probably want a dot apply or dot call on the fourth line also.
Sorry. Oh, you are correct. Oh, man. I should know this question. You are correct. Okay, so the near membrane mechanisms that we've talked about so far, in fact, will not fix this date.prototype.getDate.call of date because it's still the case that you have a date proxy that the built-in date, you have a red proxy for blue date, and nothing that we've said about the near membrane will repair this problem. The further thing is that with regard to the mechanisms that we've said so far, even the important case, which is lowercase date dot get day, will fail because you're looking up the get date method from the through inheritance, and the near membrane makes it appear that the red proxy inherits from the built-in red date.prototype, not a proxy for the date.prototype. And therefore, you're going to look up, therefore, even the typical case, the normal code, where you're looking it up on the instance, the near membrane mechanism we've talked out so far will look up the native red method, apply that to the proxy, and fail. So far, we've not only have not repaired the non-transparency that we've written off, but the substitution of local prototypes for proxies for remote prototypes has broken the normal case as well.
Yeah, so Mark, one note here, one suggestion is that when you represent that type of code, maybe you can make it in the last line there, you make it all is red because that's your side of the membrane, and the instance that you're passing is not a red, but is a proxy of a blue. Maybe you can represent it with a background in
blue. I do that with the underline. Proxies are always underlined.
Underline, okay, got it.
Yeah, I actually did have an earlier version where I started coloring the text according to the realm that it's a proxy for, and I ended up being very confused even with my own slides.
Because they underline it, I skipped up, I didn't notice it, maybe some background blue, text in red or something like that.
Background blue is interesting. The other thing that would be ideal is a blue underbar, which obviously I can do manually by just a graphical line.
That will also help, yeah.
I think that's probably
upper,
I think
line,
that's,
maybe upper line instead of on the line might help.
Okay, I think that's a great idea. I think that's what I'll do next. In the next version is I'll remove all of the underlines and then do an overline of the other realm's color. That's a good idea.
Wouldn't it be the other way around? You'd have the dates is a blue date and the overline is representing the proxy of it. So the overline would be red because it's a red proxy of a blue date.
The reason why I don't like that is that the actual text that would appear in code is the letters, not the overline. So it would still be a red variable holding the proxy where the red variable might be named date.
Okay.
But the overline doesn't appear in the code. So having that one be blue, I think is perfect. Good. Okay. So the other mechanism that you have to do in each realm that participates in a near membrane in which you're trying to provide the near illusion is the near membrane is much more invasive. The normal membrane, nothing has to be aware that you're introducing membrane. There's nothing privileged about the membrane. The objects that are interacting with the membrane don't need to know that there's membrane, don't need any special arrangement with the membrane, and the membrane also doesn't need any special arrangement with the objects. For the near membrane, what we need to do is monkey patch every built-in method that accesses an exotic internal slot. And what I mean by an exotic internal slot is an internal slot that's not one of the normal regular object defined internal slots, and which therefore the proxy mechanism does not already recognize and does not already preserve transparency for. So like the built-in square bracket prototype, square bracket, the proxy, the membrane already has built-in mechanism to make that transparent. It's accessing an exotic internal slot, so we need to monkey patch it. So we obtain GD, which is the original getDay before the monkey patch, and then we replace it with one that tries to apply the original to this, and if it fails, then it does some kind of magic to apply the original, to do something that effectively applies the original to this. The magic here is just a placeholder for what the next slide was going to explain that I never got to, which is this magic means that the monkey patch here has to be in bed with the internals of the near membrane. It has to have privileged access to the internals of the near membrane so that it can, there are several choices here. One of the things it can do is by using its special access to the near membrane, it can ask the near membrane, give me the real target, which the near membrane would have to do through the weak map lookup, because remember, we want the target, not the shadow. Because the monkey patch and the near membrane are mutually trusting, we can go ahead and just apply the built-in directly to the near target. Now, so that's one way of doing it. Another way of doing it is the magic could know that the red getDay the red native getDay corresponds to the blue native getDay. The magic could look up the blue native getDay and just apply it. So there's a variety of ways to do this. But the key thing is that they need a privileged arrangement, so that makes the near membrane really in bed with the modified primordial properties of the realm. And that's why internal slots are expensive, because you have to monkey patch every built-in method that uses the internal slots. And with regard to this, it doesn't, the as far as near membranes go, I don't think you need that the non-this access versus this access is an especially bad problem. But now we can finally answer the original puzzle, which is why is an internal slot that holds data more expensive or trickier than an internal slot that holds an object? And that is because this magic has to preserve membrane separation. So if it's an internal slot holding data, then once the data is looked up, it can just be passed back through. If it's an internal slot holding an object, then the magic has to re-engage the membrane mechanism so that the object, if the internal slot's holding an object, the object is necessarily blue. So we have to re-engage the whole near membrane mechanism, possibly creating new proxies, so that what's being returned here in this magic is a proper red side representation of whatever the blue object is. And that's not a killer problem. It's an expense. It's not so much that it's an expense. It is an expense in terms of runtime cost, but it's also an expense in terms of membranes are already very tricky things to get right. Everybody who's done a fully transparent membrane from scratch has commented on how difficult it was to finally get it all working. This adds an additional complexity, and it's an additional opportunity to make an error. Whereas the data case has less hazard for making an error. So it's more expensive in both of those ways. Neither of those are fatal. So that's why so I would say that the fifth element of the morals to our story is, if you fail at the first four elements, then the internal slots that you add should be internal slots holding data. But if all of those fail and you create an internal slot holding an object, we can still code. And Richard Gibson last time pointed out that I was wrong about the only data being a current pervasive invariant of the spec. Data view get buffer? Right. Richard, correct me if
I'm hoping that you test the comfort of people with fixing that, because I would like it to be an invariant, and I doubt anyone is relying on the behavior.
Oh, excellent.
I'm very confused by all this. What about for maps, how maps can hold objects via internal slots? How would that be fixable?
You can't get the backing store of a map. You can use the get method and the has method and things like that to prompt the map implementation to interact with it, but you can't actually retrieve it directly.
I'm trying to understand what the difference is.
Yeah.
You still have to apply these magic things and wrap the results. You still have to get to through the membrane wrapping, don't you? To be able to call that method.
Okay, so let's think through this. Dan, you might be right. Let's just step through it with the just transliterating the same example. So in a near membrane, you do a, let's say a map dot get of three. Let's say it's just a map, not a weak map, so you can just do a get of three. I do it with three, so we're not worried about the argument, it's just data. It's a near membrane, so the map will look up the get method on the native red map.prototype.get, which doesn't see the proxy for the map instance as a map. It would fail, and then the monkey patch to repair the failure would have to cope with, Dan, I think you are right. I think that my entire fear of internal slots that hold objects, I didn't see it till you asked the question because of the indirection that Richard just explained. But now that you raise it and you just walk through the example, Kariti, you've actually been doing this engineering on near membranes. What do you do about map.get?
So again, we only preserve it has been very tricky. So first of all, it has been very, very tricky to get it right. The current situation that we have is that we only do this for undeniable intrinsic. All the other ones, we just replace them with proxies. So maps and weak maps and all these other things, we don't care because you never create them from syntax. So my hope is that because obviously changing these or changing what we have is not going to happen. It's too much. We know it is too much, but my hope is that we can at least address these at the undeniable intrinsic level, maybe, or at least keep an eye on new undeniables that we introduce eventually to make sure that they don't have this issue. For the undeniables, then we do the patching. In the patching, we do a lot of gymnastics, I would say.
Okay. So
I think the biggest one is the promise. Promise is the biggest one for us.
Which one I didn't hear?
Promises.
Promises. Okay.
So that makes because it sound like segmenter doesn't need any changes. Intel segmenter can use a normal internal slot, but things like record and tuple, those add new undeniable intrinsics. Tuple adds a new undeniable intrinsic, which is tuple.prototype. And tuple prototype has methods hanging off of it, which you could monkey patch, that access internal slots of the tuple wrapper to unwrap it. So that's the kind of thing that if you have a proxy to a tuple wrapper, you might want to, do something to get through to the target because those methods either work on tuples or tuple wrappers.
I want to
dig in though, because I don't see the problem with map. It looks to me like the magic dot apply, where the first argument would be the red map.prototype.get, and the second argument would be the proxy for the blue map.
Exactly. The magic apply technique works just fine, but you do need to monkey patch it. And the whole goal of the exotic internal slot prohibition was to avoid the need to monkey patch.
That's why it's not, that's why classifying it as not fatal, but I thought we didn't have those cases, and the map get shows that we actually have those cases for very common code.
Sorry, I just want to jump in here quickly because so far I've been following the presentation, but now that we're talking about undeniable intrinsics, and talking about a set of objects that fit that definition, can we just quickly define what undeniable means here in this context?
Yeah, let me start with a first approximation, and then a previous one of these sessions noticed a flaw with the first approximation. The first approximation is that an undeniable object is an object that can be reached purely by syntax, irrespective of what monkey patching has been performed on the primordial state. So even if for every primordial object, all of its properties were replaced by something else, and for the global object, all of its global variables that led to primordials were replaced by something else. Even if all of that replacement were done, if you evaluate the expression open square bracket, close square bracket, that evaluates to a new array instance that inherits from the original array prototype. So the fact that the original array prototype is reached by syntax, even if it's not nameable, makes array.prototype undeniable. Now, the reason why that explanation is imperfect is that in order to get from the array instance to the array prototype, you have to navigate upward in the open square bracket, in the open square bracket, prototype, close square bracket direction. And if all of the built-in methods have been replaced, including object.getPrototypeOf, including object.prototype.dunderProto, including reflect.prototypeOf, if all of the methods that would enable you to ascend the prototype chain have been replaced, then it's not clear that there's any way left to get to the object that the array instance inherits from. Our practical modification of undeniable allows prototype navigation. So if you can get to it by any combination of syntax combined with ascending the inheritance chain, irrespective of what other monkey patching has happened, then it's undeniable. And
that seems like pretty accurate to me. We haven't been able to research or experiment on doing something like that, like closing everything and not using anything from the actual environment other than the evaluation process. We haven't get to that. I'm planning to do that soon. But for now, we try to identify this list of undeniable intrinsic objects, and we try to do a little bit of work on each of them. This list is nowhere, and there's not a page that you can go and see all of them. It's very hard to get them. In general, like all the undeniables are really difficult to understand. You have to read the spec and try it. And every day I find new ones, like I don't know if undefined or null should be considered undeniable intrinsic, but those are things that can be generated or NAN or whatever can be generated from code. And they are no object, obviously, but it's a growing list in my opinion. And I haven't get to research on the whole thing about replacing the entire thing and only using the evaluator.
So let me ask what I think of as the crucial question. As far as I can tell, from all of the ways we've been able to reach undeniables, and you're right, it grows over time as we come up with more clever things to do. But from all of the ways we can reach undeniables, I don't think there is a single undeniable function. I think all of the undeniables are non-functions. Is that correct?
So far, yeah. That's
no.
What I think.
Throw type error is a function.
Okay, so that's reachable from Slack.
Yeah, right, that one.
I'm glad this conversation came up because I remembered that I had an open pull request against the How We Work repository, which I just merged, that provides at least starting point definitions of all three terms.
Okay, great. So throw type error is unproblematic, but you're right that it's an undeniable function, but it's unproblematic because its only behavior is to always throw. Is there any other undeniable function? Because if not, then Kriti's observation that you're only concerned about the intersection of magic internal slot access and undeniables, it's only methods, it's only functions that access internal slots. Non-functions can't have any behavior that accesses an internal slot.
Right. Nothing
Even in that case, when you produce, when you use a function that is undeniable, I believe it's still possible that you do gymnastics to not have an issue with it, because what that function produces when you knew it is an object, and then when you access things out of that object, you can do tricks.
If the superpower of being able to access internal slots by a referenceable value is not, I don't think, is available to any undeniable.
Well, if the only undeniable function is throw type error, then clearly that's correct.
I did a pretty thorough search, and that's the only one that came up. I'm not 100% certain, but like more than 80%.
Okay.
Hey guys, I had to drop. I'll try to watch the recording and send notes if I have any comments.
Okay, let me just make one part of comment before you go. I learned a lot in going through this. The several of the comments led to real discoveries, surprises. So I really love this session.
There you go. Yeah, I think this is a great topic, and we are investing a lot on this area, and also using it in practical things that we can probably present at some point to show you what we're doing with this thing. It's looking good.
Good. Good.
All right. Bye, guys.
Okay, bye.
So I'm trying to understand where we're getting to. I personally think internal slots are really important for developing the JavaScript stuff library. You know, there are equivalent for private fields. I mean, you mentioned this property of internal slots. They differ from private fields in that it's the same private name used in each realm.
Yes.
I kind of like to think of that as, you know, we've had these proposals for defining private names in lexical declarations. You could imagine like there's one big factory function where the private names are defined outside that function, and then a new realm is created inside that function. And each time one of these classes executes, they're using the private names. I'd like to think that it corresponds, except that we don't have the lexical scoping worked out. But anyway, this whole exotic internal slot thing didn't rely on that property that the private name was reused. It was just about, proxies don't have the private name defined on. Mm-hmm. So that I want to leave that to the side and just think about how when we expand the standard library, we will want to have private fields, because you'll want to have algorithms that operate on some data that it stores, with the data being held with some integrity. Some properties of the data are always true. When things are arbitrarily subclassable or based on arbitrary object operations, you suddenly have no guarantee that you have to revalidate the data each time. So that's why you sort of inherently, as we expand the JavaScript standard library, want to be able to have private fields or internal slots. Even if they have a new name in each realm, it'll still have the same property of not being based on an object operation and not being proxy transparent. So for this reason, I was kind of disturbed by this idea that it was problematic to have, getters for data that's being held in internal slots. So given the realizations we've had, I'm wondering what the next steps are.
Yeah, given the realizations that we've had, I still believe in the morals of the story of the hierarchy of things that it would be good to avoid. And I still would like to avoid introducing new internal slots, but the the particular thing that this entire talk was trying to build up to, which was to answer the question, why is it that internal slots that hold objects are more dangerous than internal slots that hold data? I think you have cured me of that. I think the map example and walking through it, I think I just remove my caution that internal slots that hold objects would be a significant new danger.
Is not the problem that, sorry, carry on.
Well, and you know, with regard to the two kinds of membrane, for the normal transparent membrane at a realm boundary, the issue isn't the issue for practical transparency isn't internal slots so much as accessing an internal slot in a non-this argument. For the inherited accessors with getters and setters, those would not violate the this only constraint. And for the normal membrane, that's the important constraint.
Okay.
I think for me, that's sort of a key point, is that you have two objects where one can access private properties or private state from another object, and then you're trying to consolidate. You know, you've got the prototype object. The prototype object has magical access to the constructor or the prototype has magical access to the instance. If everything is accessed on this, then you don't get that that violation.
Right, you don't get that violation unless you engage in non-typical patterns that provide something other than the receiver as this argument, like an explicit dot call.
So I can't think of any TC39 proposal that's running into this particular constraint about non-this access to internal slots. But at the same time, we specifically designed the private field proposal to allow non-this access to internal slots. You know, a lot of people were saying, why not just make it a lexically scoped variable? And that might almost make sense if we only had access to this, to private fields of this. But we decided, no, it's very important to support things like equals methods that will check not only this, but also arguments, and access to private fields from static methods and things like that. So why was that important for the private fields feature, but not important to the expressivity of future JavaScript standard library features?
Okay, so once again, we need to distinguish the regular, fully transparent membrane at a realm boundary versus the goals of the near membrane. Historically, I only had my eyes on the first because I didn't know that a near membrane was possible. For the first one, classes in two different realms, in the absence of new mechanism, like the kind of new mechanism that you suggested a moment ago, classes in two realms necessarily cannot see each other's privates. So putting a realm boundary between them, sorry, putting a membrane between those realms, putting a membrane that coincides with the realm boundary maintains full transparency. You can't access the internal slot. I mean, you can't access the private field for a different reason, but in both cases, you can't access it. So there's no, the problem with internal slots is that between realms without a membrane, they're accessible. Between realms with a membrane, they're not. And that causes the non-transparency.
Well, I was trying to explain before, but maybe I was talking too much in the air. I think there's a missing primitive here, which is the ability to declare a private field, a private name in a lexical scope that's outside of the class, that's shared between multiple executions of the class.
Right. I was specifically saying aside from that proposal.
Ah, right. I agree with you then.
Okay. And historically, I mean, I've never heard that proposal until you said it a moment ago.
Justin Ridgewell's proposed it in committee.
Oh, with private symbols you're talking about.
No, not with private symbols, with the private hash food declaration. And I'm interested in this proposal. I just, you know.
The private hash food declaration that was cross realm?
Well, I'm saying if you imagine realms being like you have a factory function that produces the realm. And I mean, if you imagine that this is where realms come from, that they come from some JavaScript code that has like private hash foo and then a function that's the realm factory, and that has a class inside of it that references the outer private hash foo declaration. This would be sort of if you were to implement the construction of a new realm in JavaScript, it would be explained by this construct.
I think I'm not following.
Maybe I can come back to this another day and make an actual presentation like you did.
Okay, I think that would be helpful. I think I need to see some code. But just to wrap up the historical excuse I'm making, is that I never thought about whatever it is that Justin was proposing at the same time that I'm thinking about these issues. When I was thinking about membrane transparency and internal slots versus classes, I only thought about a private state that was per realm.
Okay, let me try explaining. Instead of thinking about realms, let's just think about two classes. But it's actually the same class syntactically, or it could be two classes syntactically, but because it's using Justin's features, reusing the private name. So it could be that you have a function and the class is inside the function. The function returns the class. So it's two separate class executions with two different identities of the prototype, but they're using the same private name because they have this new primitive. You could make a membrane that translates between those two, this sort of near membrane, except instead of between realms, it's between the two executions of this class. Does this make sense?
I understand much of it. I'm puzzled by some, and I can't imagine the answer to my next question taking less than half hour discussion. That's okay. I mean, I'm glad we've got it stated, and then we can revisit this next time. But I think this was a tremendous session, and I really thank you for the surprise, because I really learned some really important things in the session.
Do you want to say your question just that I could think about it before next week? If that would be okay, maybe we don't have enough time.
Is the private name reified into a first class object so that something that's outside the lexical scope can nevertheless define things using the same private name?
Ah, well, that's a design question. We could say no, or we could say yes. I think if we say yes, it would have to be a primitive. And that's something that I've been thinking a lot about. It would take a lot longer to explain as you.
Right, okay.
I don't think it would be able to do it if I didn't know.
Okay, so if the answer is no, then the only per realm private state still applies, because a compilation unit is always evaluated in one realm. Script or a module.
I agree with that. If the answer is no, then it implies that.
Okay, good, good. I look forward to our next discussion. This was great.
Yeah. Thanks, great chatting.
Thank you, Dan, for suggesting this topic, and thank you, Yulia, as well, especially for generalizing the topic to capturing these invariants and getting them written down for everyone.
Yeah.
On that topic, I would like to raise my intention to actually put this on the agenda for this meeting, not with a specific invariance, that we've been discussing, but more the concept of writing down the invariants and inviting more people to add their invariants and their thoughts to this. Are there any objections to that?
I'm very enthusiastically supportive that you should do that.
Okay, then that'll be appearing on the agenda in tomorrow's timeframe.
Okay, and what I might do is put on the agenda a presentation of some specific invariants that are dear to me, where my talk would necessarily be after your talk.
That sounds great.
Great.
Let me add to the chorus, I enthusiastically endorse this.
Say again.
I want to third the enthusiastic endorsement of.
I hear three. Do I hear four? Do I hear four? are there any? are there any other topics we wish to discuss before stopping the recording? All right. Thank you.